Are search engines reinforcing racism, or are they neutral? Are certain groups of people portrayed differently? These questions are becoming even more relevant in the context of the Black Lives Matter movement, which is bringing issues of race, inequality, and discrimination at the top of the news agenda. Hello everyone, and welcome to TC Talks. Our guest today is Safiya Noble. She's associate professor at UCLA, and she's the author of Algorithms of Oppression, How Search Engines Reinforce Racism. Safiya, thank you for joining us. The Black Lives Matter movement has started a number of conversations around race, around discrimination, around inequality. You use the word oppression, and you talk about a form of oppression which really materializes itself very evidently, but yet not many people are consciously aware of it, and that is data and algorithm discrimination. Tell us more.
You know, I started looking at Google in particular and search engines because the public is so reliant upon these to understand and make sense of all kinds of things that are happening in the world and in their lives. And one of the things that I see is that people and communities and ideas are often deeply misrepresented, the same kinds of communities that have typically historically been discriminated against. That information is often used and taken to make a whole host of decisions about people. College admissions, looking through to see the credibility of a people, of a community, of an individual. These technologies hold an incredible amount of power in our society and over our lives, and we really need to be paying attention.
Ahead of school, I just started experimenting, and I searched yoga teacher images, and there wasn't a single person of color. I searched for professional hairstyles, and 90% of the faces that showed up in there were white. But then when I searched for unprofessional hairstyles, there were a lot of black women in there. Now, one of the points that you make is that search engines are not libraries, but they are a business product. So they are an advertising platform. Is there a fundamental disconnect, you reckon, in terms of public expectations? And if so, what are really the consequences for our democracies and our civil liberties?
I think so much about how many parents and teachers, for example, all over the world tell students and young people, just Google it, as if it's the authoritative voice on what's happening in the world. Not only, for example, is yoga misrepresented by having just young, thin, beautiful white women as the representation. When you did searches for black girls, you were greeted with almost complete pornography. So, you know, it's not just what other people come to know about a subject or about you, but also what you come to know about yourself. And I think that's incredibly dangerous.
You also write in your book that we are now becoming the products the platform sells. What do you mean with that?
The public really doesn't understand the amount of data extraction that is happening and the ways in which we are being commodified and sold all over the internet to all kinds of platforms. And you know, I once heard a very senior ranking government official in the United States say, as far as the government was concerned, who we are is our data profile. Now imagine all the places that you've been on the internet out of curiosity, kind of your own freedom to read. How in the world could that be who you are? But these are the kinds of consequences I think that are at stake, and those data profiles will matter in the future in terms of our opportunities or lack of opportunities.
Going back to Black Lives Matter, and especially searches around George Floyd, which has been obviously a pivotal moment, not only for the black community, but really globally around the world. What have you noticed when it comes to that?
In the case of George Floyd, we saw very quickly that Google was auto-completing criminal record in relationship to his name. That's a very powerful signal that not only are people searching on that, but also people are optimizing content to try and criminalize George Floyd. And of course, we know this is deeply tied to rationalizing his murder. We saw the same thing happen with Mike Brown. We saw it happen with Trayvon Martin. And of course, these feed into the dehumanization of black lives, which is exactly the call that's in the streets right now, is that this dehumanization leads to relentless murders of black people. There's a whole host of people using these technologies and trying to make sense of the world.
On the other hand, how does the white supremacist movement exploit these platforms, if they do?
Well, they do. People mess with hashtags, for example, on Twitter or Instagram, where they might say justice for George Floyd and spell his name incorrectly so that people can unwittingly use the wrong hashtags. These are kind of practices of disinformation to destabilize social activism and coalescing around the human rights and civil rights movement that is Black Lives Matter, that is so important right now.
And obviously in the US, you guys are gearing up to an important election in November. How has the landscape changed between the previous election, where obviously social media played a very important role into the conversation we had? How do you see this going?
We also have right-wing governments around the world, including our own, who are also seeking to weaponize and use these platforms in their interests. You know, using these platforms, let's say, to incite violence, which is, of course, is the most recent crisis that we've seen in the United States. People who are calling for greater protections to the public and that our human and civil rights not be denied, those calls get turned around by people who are actually calling for the annihilation of those people. And so these are the tensions that we're watching.
And so going back lastly to the platforms, we talked about racism and misogyny embedded into the algorithms. What are the alternatives there for people who really don't want to be part of this?
It's a great question. I mean, one of the things that I raise in the book is that we should be thinking more about what happens when our information landscape is controlled by multinational corporations, for example, who in many cases are so big that they fail. You know, should some of these companies be broken up? Should they be localized in different ways? That might be one set of solutions from some quarters. Others of us might argue that we need more public interest kinds of technologies that care about and foreground the kinds of things we're talking about, anti-discrimination law, civil rights law, that are not motivated to make money, but in fact are motivated to bolster democracy. And I think these are the kinds of things we should be talking about and debating right now, especially as we go into election season.
Safiya, it's been a pleasure talking to you. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
That's all for this time. You've been watching TC Talks, the spin-off of the Trust Conference, our global human rights forum taking place every November in London. Do subscribe to this YouTube channel to make sure that you don't miss any of the amazing videos we got lined up for you. Thanks for watching and see you next time.